Because we have a foreign visitor, Susanna Juban, who is a postdoctoral researcher at the Amsterdam School of Heritage, Memory and Material Culture, and she works also as a DAAT and Marie Curie Prime Fellow at the University of Constance. I have a very, very long text about everything she's done.
No.
Basically, she works on the topic of contemporary European memory and the relations between violence, memory, and space, and on the post-Holocaust politics of dead bodies. Today she's going to talk to us about ashes. So I think it's better to give you the floor and show us your research.
So since I work in a context where exhumations are actually impossible, I approached the topic from a slightly different perspective, and as Marie said, I will focus on ashes today, and they are afterlives in the post-Holocaust context. And my presentation will be divided into three parts. In the first one, I will provide you with an example from which then, which actually spurred me and gave me incentive to think about the specificity of ashes. Then I will contextualize it historically a bit, and then also try to build some kind of theory around it, and then I will go completely crazy theoretically. So please be prepared for that. This is, of course, a paraphrase of the title of Zoe Hausland and Rosemary Johnson's Disturbing Bodies, based on the interpretative interplay with the double meaning of the syntax. And I'm sorry, I internalized the German academic habitus and I will read. So please let me know if I'm going too fast and not loud enough. In early December 2012, a small one-person exhibition was held in a private gallery in the southern Swedish city of Lund, capturing rapt media attention and receiving enormous international publicity. Covered worldwide by daily newspapers and online information services ranging from Der Spiegel to Jerusalem Post, from Art Daily to Fox News, the exhibition featured one photograph, Red Dawn, Gerings Hunting Lodge from 2009, a sound installation, The Final Repose of Jane Bulmer Burroughs from 2011, and a cycle of nine paintings, Majdanek 1989 from 2010, by Swedish sound and visual artist Carl Michael van Hausdorff. It bore the title Memory Works. The scandal broke soon after the exhibition's first and only review, written by an art critic, Tol Birgren, and harshly disapproving of the displayed images, had been published in a Swedish daily Sydsvenskan. Immediately afterwards, almost all national and international papers took up the story. It centered on a painting allegedly created by van Hausdorff by covering paper with paint made of human ashes mixed with water. The ashes, gathered by the artist in the crematorium at the site of the former concentration and extermination camp at Majdanek, Poland, in the winter of 1989, had been stowed by him in a matchbox whose contents he had removed on site on the spur of the moment and replaced with burned human remains. This information, together with the explanation as to why, in 2010, von Hausdorff decided to make use of the ashes collected 20 years previously at the former Nazi camp and brought by him from Poland to Sweden, were available at the webpage of Martin Brüder Gallery, where the work was exhibited, from mid-November 2011 until exhibition's early closure on December 10, 2012. Since I learned about the exhibition after it was closed already, In describing it, I rely on press coverage and research interviews with both Breda and the gallerist and Carmichael von Hausdorff, and a very short and very rare first-hand description of the exhibition by Tanya Nobel, described in her MA thesis. As maintained on the gallery's homepage and in the handout given to the visitors of the exhibition, von Hausdorff kept the box filled with incinerated human remains in his Stockholm studio without really knowing what to do with it, but at the same time not being able to simply throw it away because, I quote, the material was too emotionally charged with the cruelties that had taken place at the former camp, end of quote. Von Hausdorff's resolution to transform its contents into an artwork was dictated by the need, driven by empathy, as he says, to restore the dignity of those exterminated and burned at Majdanek, and to face his own haunting memory of the visit to the concentration camp. When in 2015 I asked von Hausdorff about his trip to Poland and his decision to lay hold of the ashes, he described in detail both his impressions and the general circumstances of his trip to the former camp, in fact, the first of this kind he had ever undertaken. This was the first visit to a concentration or examination camp by von Hausdorff. Taken on during a work-related stay in the country on the invitation of Polish artists, the emotionally charged walk through the site in his memory embarrassingly unkempt and neglected, culminated in the building with which houses the crematory ovens. It was his shock at the discovery that, I quote, unprotected, abandoned human remains, end of quote, had been left lying around at the installation used to cremate the people to whom they once belonged, that acted, as he claims, as an incentive to take the ashes from the camp. The very presence in his studio of the box containing human remains had a besetting and unsettling quality, I quote. It represented something. It was talking to me in a very serious way, noted von Hausdorff. I knew I should attend to it. Something had to be done. The resulting series of 11 paintings, interestingly reduced to one in the press and media coverage and misnamed memory works, was itself extremely moving for its author. The abstract images, made of grey and brown streaks on small pieces of paper, could be said to depict crowded, trapped human figures. Von Hausdorff. When I stepped back and looked at the pictures, they spoke to me. Figures appeared, as if the ashes contained energy or memories of souls from people. People tortured, tormented, and murdered by other people in one of the 20th century most ruthless wars. A statement not particularly surprising coming from the artist well known for his endeavors to embrace the other side and to literally give voice to material memories inscribed in objects and landscapes. The first review was titled Stolen Ashes Banalize the Holocaust and framed the paintings as a work based on a particularly controversial theft. Before long, the description of the desecration of the Jewish bodies was put forward by Solomon Schulman, a prominent representative of the Jewish community in Lund, pointing out the possibility that his relatives were exterminated in the camp and that their bodily remains were profaned by von Hausdorff's artistic intervention. Schulman, who himself had not seen the exhibition, constructed memory works as both sickening and necrophiliac. On 5th December, not even a week after the publication of Billgren's critical review, a private complaint was filed with the local police over the, I quote, disturbance of the peace of the dead, brought about by the ash painting, a felony carrying penalties under Swedish criminal law. Even though the probe was dropped after a couple of days due to lack of evidence and the fact that the deed in question was perpetrated abroad, it definitely had international resonance. Animosity condemned by various Jewish communities and organizations, both in Israel and abroad, the painting had been firmly established as a radical and repulsive violation of the respect for the dead, Kavod Hamet, which constitutes one of the fundamental principles of Judaism. As stated by Abraham Foxman, the head of the Anti-Defamation League in New York, I quote, "The use of human remains in art is disrespectful and offensive," period. But what makes this so much worse is that Carmichael von Hausdorff is also doing it at the expense of Hitler's victims. End of quote. In an open letter to von Hausdorff, written by the representative of European office of the Simon Wiesenthal Center, Simon Schmalz went as far as to compare the actions of the artist with the atrocities carried out by the Nazis. I quote, "Mr. von Hausdorff, you, like the Nazis' use of human skin for lampshades and fat to produce soap, have similarly twice murdered the bodies that were once the ashes you have desecrated, turning art into a domination. Hitler, as an aspiring painter, would surely applaud." In no uncertain terms, he demanded that the painting should be brought back to State Museum at Majdanek and buried in a mausoleum housing the ashes of its victims, erected at the site in 1969. Judy Montago, a co-editor and columnist of Jerusalem Post, probably not fully aware of the fact that the ashes from concentration and extermination camps were in fact brought to Israel and buried there, a point to which I will return to shortly, formulated an alternative demand. Instead of desecrating those human remains at rest, von Hausdorff would have done better to first visit the Jewish states, walk through the halls of Yad Vashem, and absorb their message, then finally scoop up a measure of Israeli soil and leave it reverently behind him at Majdanek. The prompt response issued by Polish museum authorities, although conspicuously lacking in strong religious and political undertones, was also unequivocally critical of von Hausdorff's actions. I'm sorry, I have some problem with my throat. The theft of human remains is as serious as stealing the Arbeit macht frei sign from the entrance gate to Auschwitz I, the official statement suggested, but it also grounded the exceptional grievousness of the deed and its mishandling of bodily remains of camp victims. Moreover, it claimed, I quote, "It is certain that the Swedish artists did not come into the possession of the Majdanek ashes in a legal way." Building on this, State Museum of Majdanek also filed an official complaint with the prosecutor's office. The resulting Polish investigation, opened in early January 2013, centered therefore on two intrinsically entwined allegations, accusing the artist both of the theft of human remains from the site of the former camp in 1989, and of the resulting profanation in 2010. In line with Polish criminal law, for the latter offense alone, the artist could have faced a sentence of 2 years of imprisonment. Nevertheless, the Polish investigation was also dropped in April 2014, because the statute of limitation for crimes committed in 1989 had long since expired, and the painting was created by a foreigner outside Polish borders, and the crime was considered to be beyond Polish jurisdiction. As both von Hausdorff and Martin Brieder, the owner of the gallery where the work was shown, informed me, and which is interesting, it was not the first nor the last gallery where the cycle was housed. The paintings were never secured and examined as forensic evidence. So when I say ash, actually, it's always in quotation marks. Whether this decision was based on the conviction that an equivocal of DNA or any other identification of the ashes was practically impossible, or on the fear that such an examination would itself be framed as a violation from the point of view of Jewish religious law, is uncertain. Nevertheless, the paintings were not brought back to Majdanek for reburial, as requested by the Wiesenthal Center, and remain in the possession of their creators to this day. The scandal surrounding the controversial work did, however, have some tangible results. In February 2013, a system was established in a crematorium preserved at the site of the former camp in Majdanek. This considered the transparent glass curtains blocking visitors' access to the furnaces in which the bodies of its victims were buried. Nevertheless, even these belated attempts to protect
The residues of ash remaining at the installations testify mainly to an inescapable reality. Even those belated attempts to protect the residues of ash remaining at the installations testified merely to the inescapable reality made obvious by Van Hausbrouck's work and confirmed by the representatives of the State Museum at Majdanek. When the camp was operational, human remains were scattered over the whole area of the camp. What is more, like in other camps, when Majdanek was still operating, the Nazis used the ashes to construct roads and fertilize plants. Provisionally buried after the liberation of the camp in a mound created in the immediate vicinity of the crematoria, in the late 60s transferred into a newly erected mausoleum in which they are exhibited until today and annually covered with annealed glass, the bodily remains of the victims of the camp were never entirely addressed, as Judy Montagu would wish. In 1989, they were still to be found in the camp's crematorium, and most probably linger until today as a sediment on the surfaces of various material structures remaining at the site, or resurfaced from mass graves as a result of the processes of natural exhumation, as is and was the case on the sites of the former extermination camp at Belzec, Sobibór, and Treblinka. The challenging unpredictability of the effective and practical responses to this disturbing presence is, one can assume, directly proportional to the uncontainability of the burned remains itself. In anthropological perspectives on disturbing bodies, Zoe Crosland and Rosemary Joyce write of the ways in which human remains can and do trouble the living, forcing them to act and to react. They do so by their material qualities, through hauntings, dreams, and other forms of presence, and through political claims and challenges often articulated around them. By listing these diverse and seemingly unrelated modalities of disturbance, operating in and or through the realms of materiality, affect, and politics, Crosland and Joyce hint, in fact, on the ambivalent and liminal status of their bodies, or better yet, at their complex, multi-layered ontology. Among its many articulations, establishing at the heart of ontological characteristic of human remains the collapse of distinction between past and present, present absent, animate, inanimate, nature, culture, human animal, person, thing, the latter, person thing, has proven particularly prominent in theorization of the power of the dead exert over the living, especially when encountered in their corporeal presence, and in addressing the emotive impact they create, ranging from fear or disgust to an urge to care and protect. This lies first and foremost in the specificity of human remains. Now I quote Keenan and A.L. Weitzman, as the kind of object from which the trace of the subject can never be fully ever removed. The suspension between the state of being a person and human and social animal and a thing renders dead bodies disturbing and invites varying responses animating and in turn animated by affects, culture and religious sensitivities and political interests. On the level of theory and scientific practice, this translates into Crosland's categorical instability of the corpse.
Water, just speak slowly, take a break, whatever you need.
My doctor told me to stay in bed for at least a week.
Oh, yeah. I'll bring you a bed here.
Following this conceptual trajectory, various scholars have attempted to unpack the power of human remains hold over the living on an individual, social, and political plane. Thomas Lechner writes of the work of the dead, their ability to organize imagination, structure existence, and make social works, and states, I quote, that the relationship between the two conceptions of the dead, their matter, on the one hand, and beings who have a social existence on the other is what allows bones, ashes and names to do their work. Howard Williams, building upon Alfred Gell's theory of agency of inanimate objects, attribute the agency of dead bodies to the fact that they embody and carry on not only the memory of the dead, but also the deferred intentionality. The physicality and materiality of the dead body can be seen as an extension of the deceased personhood, actively affecting the remembrance of the deceased by the living and structuring social action. Just Fontaine, John Harris, and Kara Crompidge pushed the discussion one step further in their explorations of the implications of dual ontology of human remains, both as things, objects, and as extensions of one's unique human beings that is subjects, in terms of their ambivalent and uneasy subjecthood, objecthood. Being neither one nor quite the other, human remains paradoxically act and affect as both, as our tokens of deferred human agency and as things in their idiosyncratic and specific physicality. In this, the representatives of the bone collective take the power of the dead as a vantage point and critically engage with their one-directional theoretizations, most notably the ideas proposed by Catherine Everdery in her political Life of Dead Bodies, where human remains are constructed as multivocal and politically efficacious but mute symbolic vehicles invested by the living with various cultural and political meanings. Through relocating the focus from politics of the dead, as practiced by those who are still alive, to the effects of encounters with human remains beyond or below their intention and control, the slant works against reductive conceptualizations of dead bodies still, to an extent guiding the interpretations proposed by Leclerc and Howard Williams. It is, after all, not only through the lingering presence of the deceased personhood as individual with social and political existence that the material remains can act upon people. The very material presence of human remains, bones, skulls, flesh, and of the composing bodies, and the properties they embody, their visuality, smells, textures, entail their own forms of or modes of agency, calling forth and shaping the responses of the living. Yet if the ability of human remains to disturb rests exactly in their inherent and irreducible excessiveness, grounded equally in their emotive materiality as human substances and their quote, affective presence as dead persons, who continue to make demands on society, it also inevitably invites an urge to make them into either one or the other. Unfolding through techniques of subjectification and objectification, the hegemonic closure of the meaning of human remains reconstitutes them either into mere objects or into appropriate, least meaningful subjects, be it an evidence or a crime, or an object of mourning, that's Eva Dmitska, corpus delicti of political subject, that's Thomas Lequer, or an anonymous victim of a concentration camp, or the material basis of narco. Notwithstanding this, the controversies surrounding Van Hasselt's Majdanek, to a great extent stemming from the fact that the work cut across and in this way somewhat blurred the line between the objecthood and subjecthood of human remains, speaks not only to the palpable tension generated by the direct juxtaposition of the outcomes involved. The case of the contentious ash painting also enables an illustration of the problems brought about or forward by the specific materiality of ashes and burnt human remains as distinct from that of both. The reduction or transformation of human body into inorganic matter occurs on shapeless material composed of pulverized bone fragments and elements, constitutes a radical intervention into its material register, rendering the former living being indistinguishable and almost intangible as subject. Yet the reduction of to ashes affects also the material composition of remains in their very thinness, their substance and shape, leading to the deconstitution of the corpse as an object.
with an easily identifiable and recognizable form. In this sense, in the Holocaust objects, Bożena Szalkros notes, I quote, "Turning the body into ashes transforms its previous visually defined form into its lack, into formlessness." The formlessness of ash, as Nazis were well aware and of which way they definitely intended to take full advantage, renders both the subjecthood and objecthood of human remains much less detectable and tangible. Turned into a pile of ashes, mixed up with that of the others, the human corpse not only loses all traces of its individuality as subject, which bones and skulls always bear at least to a certain extent, but it also oscillates at the borderline between material being and nothingness, as phrased by Zewald. The intermediacy of material evasiveness of ash may therefore present difficulties not only for forensic scientists, but also for the very techniques of subjectification and objectification. Both subjects and tangible objects are not easily made from the enigmatic materiality of ash. In the immediate aftermath of the Holocaust, this was made particularly manifest in the radical reconfigurations of individual and collective practices related to the dead, and in the culturally and religiously informed redefinitions of what, in fact, constitutes a dead body. The challenge posed by ashes of the victims of concentration and extermination camps, burned by the Nazis en masse, in sophisticated indoor machines of mass incineration or in the makeshift outdoor crematoria, and afterwards disposed in the rivers, instrumentalized for industrial purposes and agrarian purposes, or mixed with sand and buried in mass graves, disturbed, first and foremost, the letter of the Jewish religious law. The prescription of cremation, of central importance for halakhically sanctioned mortuary ritual, draw a fine distinction between the body of the dead and the ashes, which were considered impure and of essentially different nature, and were generally not admitted for burial at the Jewish cemetery. According to Robert Jan van Pelt, in the view of the fact that in the late 19th and early 20th century, the issue of cremation established a firm line, a boundary maker of sorts, separating the religious Jewish community from its secularizing and Christian neighbors, who increasingly embracing cremation, the practice of mass or multi-corpse incineration performed by the Nazis could, I quote, be interpreted as a symbol of a particularity of the German assault on the Jews. Although perhaps not intended as such, the practice of dispossessing the bodies of victims of concentration and extermination camps in an attempt to erase the traces of the crimes yielded various redefinitions of religious duty pertaining to buried remains, aimed at undoing the double violence of the subjectification, amongst other through innovative rabbinical rulings. The following advice came from Rabbi Menachem Mendel Kirschbaum of Frankfurt am Main as early as 1939 in the wake of mass arrests of German Jews during the wave of pogroms that swept through the country on 9th of November 1938. Responding to families who had received the ashes of their loved ones sent to them by the concentration camps administration for burial, the rabbi said that the urns with burnt remains should be buried in Menachem the same way as they would in the coffin. That was the first present. Nevertheless, it was precisely the impossibility to individualize the victims and separate the dead from one another, which resulted from multi-corpse incineration, that according to David Deutsch particularly troubled the post-war rabbinical responses and their outlook on the status of ashes. In the absence of precedents and clear guidelines regarding the mass burial and reburial, religious authorities acted in a condition of, as he says, forced innovativeness, oftentimes structured along the lines of political and ideological interest. This pertains especially to the question of exhumation and reburial of ashes and their religious classification. While the rabbis representing an ultra-orthodox stance hesitantly considered exhumations and reburial of burnt remains, if not impermissible, then at least devoid of immediate religious value, as did Rabbi Greenwald in his volume pertaining to Auschwitz-Birkenau recommending the scattering of ashes around the graves containing the complete bodies and framing inhumation of ashes as non-obligatory but permissible, the Orthodox rabbis with Zionist political orientation often openly advocated for mass reburial of burned remains from the camps, mass graves and execution sites in the newly established Jewish state. This was the case of Rabbi Shimon Efrati, who in the late 40s constructed the duty to protect incinerated remains and bring them for burial in Israel as an obligation as much religious as it was political. In the words of David Dodge, I quote, Efrati took advantage of the unprecedented nature of post-war mass graves and his Zionist ideology to link reburial with national identity. End of quote. In turn, of course, in the political logic of the state, national identity was linked with reburial of the ashes of the holy martyrs, as they were framed also at that time. In the face of the Holocaust and the unprecedented scale and nature of disposal of human remains through cremation, erasing both the individuality and history of the dead, the outcomes of the religious and political project of re-subjectification of remains, rendering them into clearly defined collective subjects, undoubtedly also in the interests of the community and the state, sometimes coincided. Yet, that this religiously and politically driven process of making the ashes of Holocaust victims into appropriately meaningful subjectivities was in fact highly complex, multi-layered and at times controversial reading was made abundantly clear by historical studies recently carried out by Doron Barr and Jean-Marc Dreyfus. Both locate their analysis against the backdrop of struggles over political legitimization and community making evolving and revolving around human remains from the Holocaust in Israel, epitomized by a long-standing conflict between two centers of Holocaust commemoration, the Chamber of the Holocaust, religiously orientated, established in 1949, and Yad Vashem, 1953, over the right to gather and rebury the ashes of the dead, and to construct their sanctity in either religious or civil terms, which ultimately secular Yad Vashem proved to be, of course, more successful. Both Barr and Dreyfus nevertheless point out the central importance also for the development of this national commemorative idiom of the remarkably widespread bottom-up practice of collecting ashes from the sites of the former concentration and extermination camps, undertaken in the immediate aftermath of the Holocaust by diverse actors, individual and collective. Survivors, their families, families of the victims, association of former inmates, and representatives of various Jewish institutions, social, political, religious, and cultural. Unsurprisingly, there exists a rich documentation on the ways in which private individuals and Jewish community organizations, both in Israel and abroad, come into possession of burned human remains assembled in the vicinity of mass graves of the, or in the camp's crematoria and carried from the sites in boxes, bags and makeshift urns. Many visited the sites of mass murder before emigrating from Poland, Germany and Austria. Others travel to those countries with the sole purpose of paying the respect to the dead and collecting human remains. The ashes were smuggled illegally or transferred through diplomatic channels sent by post. On many occasions, Polish authorities, including the heads of the State Museum of Majdanek, of course, sent the remains gathered at the camp on the request of Jewish community organizations, religious associations, municipalities, and survivors. With time, the phenomenon took on a more organized form and was handled mostly by collective bodies. In the 50s in Israel, it became centralized under the auspices of the Ministry of Religious Welfare with Mount Zion and later Yad Vashem, designated as the sole location at which to bury the ashes, which interestingly was brought to the site up until the early 70s, and by also by individuals who for more than two decades kept the remains in their private possession. Yet even before the religious political codification of the treatment of the Holocaust ashes, the inhumation of burned remains at local Jewish cemeteries in the newly erected monuments unfolded mostly within an emergent communal purpose of memorialization called forth by the very commonality of the practice of collecting art. As in Europe, in Israel, a quote on Baron, the burial of ashes in various locations, including cemeteries, often served as a basis for the construction of monuments near places where members of the community live, thereby providing a focal point of remembrance and sanctity around which community members gather. End of quote. This corresponded with the way in which the dead were constructed through this dislocated surrogate mortuary rituals performed in the absence of bodies and proper burial sites. Indistinguishable, formless, vulnerable, the ashes simultaneously stood for individuals, relatives, loved ones, friends, and in the words of Dreyfus, represented the victims as a collective whole. Perhaps the most striking metaphorical framing for this, of the subjectifying dynamics behind the practice of collection and burial of the ashes comes from Simon Wiesenthal, the co-founder of the Jewish Documentation Center in Leeds in 1943, and himself a survivor of several concentration camps. In 1949, on behalf of the Committee of Austrian Jews and the Association of the Former Concentration Inmates in Austria, Wiesenthal himself arranged for the most spectacular transport of burned human remains. Gathered at the concentration camps and execution sites in Austria, and sent to belong to 200,000 Jews who had been murdered in the Holocaust, which is of course impossible to confirm, the ashes were brought to Israel in a glass coffin containing 30 urns decorated in the colors of Israeli flag. Although for Wiesenthal the decision to immune those remains outside Austria was dictated first and foremost by a need to put through a demand for accountability for Zionist leaders in Palestine for their failure to act during the Holocaust, the receipt of ashes in Israel took the form of series of politically and religiously coordinated public events in which tens of thousands of people participated. Both in Israel, in Tel Aviv and in Jerusalem, where the glass coffin was eventually inhumed, the display of urns housing the ashes of the victims of the Holocaust gathered crowds. People wept, many brought with them small containers filled with remains from the sites where their relatives or communities were killed. Others approached the coffin as if it contained the ashes of their loved ones who died in concentration camps in Austria. Reflecting in retrospect on the effective political and symbolic power of the glass coffin carrying burned human remains of anonymous victims of the Holocaust, Wiesenthal observed. The glass box has suddenly become a kind of looking glass in which the faces of many, many could be reflected. Friends from the ghetto, companions from the concentration camps, people who had been beaten to death, died of starvation, been handed into electrified fence. I could see the panicked faces of Jews who were whipped and cupped into the gas chambers, chased behind by human animals, devoid of conscience and feelings, who would not hear their long plea, let them be. Perceiving the formless and undistinguishable ashes through Wiesenthal's looking glass did not entail, however, merely projecting onto them memories of the known and unknown dead. It also irrevocably transformed their matter into human remains of once living persons and communities. This occurred in spite of the fact that no radical shifts in the material registers of the remains could actually be detected, apart from that brought about by the attempt to contain the ashes by putting them into boxes, urns, and bags. The reconstituting of the inorganic matter, soil and debris into ash, unfolded therefore firstly through the performative gesture of collecting them from the sites of the former camps and mass burial, an expressive, although often purely instinctive, act of protection of and care. This impulse a further set of practices, many of which, in the absence of clear prescriptions and guidelines, had yet to be invented. Thus, even before there existed clearly defined frames in which to articulate the collectivized identities of the dead, such as holy martyrs of Jewish bodies, the transfer and burial of the ashes at the cemeteries and in the monuments throughout Europe and Israel was as much an act of grief as an ethical and political project in which re-subjectivation of remains served to undo the work of double dehumanization carried out at the camps. Only afterwards would the looking glass claim to reflect, or better yet, project the gaze of the state grounding its own legitimacy in the politics of dead bodies. Unsurprisingly then, seen from this political perspective, von Hassewoll's contentious artistic endeavor to conjure up ghosts of the people incinerated at Majdanek by giving them shape to their shapeless and abandoned remains bears no resemblance to religiously and politically charged discursive and performative strategies framing the material from which his paintings were made as desecrated Jewish bodies, and anyone would like to admit. In both cases, the basic intention is, after all, to restore the dignity of the dead by separating the indistinguishable ashes into individual beings or into dead political subjects, to borrow a phrase from Auguste Fontaine. There are obviously many reasons why van Hassewoll's privatized politics of the dead, performed beyond or below established religious and political attributions, was from the outset doomed to meet with condemnation and criticism. The most conspicuous being the breaching of the Jewish law, the law in general, and claiming ownership of the remains. Yet I would argue it was first of all the obscenity of the gesture, constructing the ashes simultaneously as bodily remains of anonymous victims of the concentration camp, and a material basis for an artwork, the engagement with both subjecthood and objecthood of ash that unlocked its disturbing potential. In von Hassewoll's looking glass, the remains transpire to be both beings with social existence and mere matter. Now there should be a long part on the other strategy, the objectification, and by objectification, in this particular context, I didn't mean scientific practices or constructing bodies, ashes into forensic evidence, but I'm rather thinking of the afterlives of the human remains at the sites in Poland as they were approached by local Poles who made very practical uses of the ashes also to fertilize their fields, but first of all in order to perform searches for gold and valuables which are allegedly hidden at the sites of the are buried with remains at the sites of the camps. What I mean is obviously a grave robbery, and by grave robbery I do not mean merely economical or practice structured by economical means, but I understand it in terms of more in terms of political practice of alterity and dehumanization. But because of time limits and economy of my presentation, I will move to the crazy theoretical part. That is a third trajectory, so to say. One would be the one leading to subjectification, the other to objectification, both considered as ethical and political projects. And now the third trajectory. Interestingly, the conceptual venture in the third direction, bringing to the foreground the uncontainable materiality of ashes, always resisting transformation into full and fully controllable and containable objects, could also be facilitated by art. Looked at through this particular prism, the objectifying gaze, inscribed in the famous photograph Lynn Miller in Hitler's bathtub, taken by David Sherman, makes manifest that the trajectories of the material afterlives of human remains can be indeed very unexpected. Taken in Adolf Hitler's Munich apartment of the evening of 30th April 1945, after Miller's and Sherman's working day as photographers at the concentration camp in Dachau, this dense and multilayered image could be seen, as Martin Brudet pointed out, as the first, probably largely unintentional, presentation
of the ashes of the Holocaust victims in contemporary art. Miller's books, standing on the mat in front of the legendary bath, in which the American photographer was trying to, I quote, wash off the odors of Dachau, were, according to Sherman, still covered with the dust of the concentration camp. Obviously, it is impossible, again, to determine whether the books really bore traces of the burned remains of the victims of the camp. Nevertheless, the further possibility that they did makes clear that ash sediments in unpredictable ways and according to material trajectories that are beyond or unrelated to human control intervention. To slightly paraphrase Piotr also. Exactly in the intermediary zone between man-made and materiality-driven trajectories of the afterlife of the human remains that I would like to locate my reflection on their unobtrusive political agency, and in this way I reconceptualize the politics of the body from the perspective of the bodies and not the living. Moving beyond the either-or paradigms of subjectification-objectification, the aim is to explore the implications of the ontological in-betweenness of ash, both from the perspective of its uneasy objecthood-subjecthood and its material oscillation between being and nothingness. In this respect, the ideas developed by Jacques Derrida in his smooth book Cinders, as a reflection on and in response to the Holocaust, proved particularly inspiring. Framed as, I quote, what remains without remaining from the Holocaust, from all the burning, from the incineration, end of quote, the cinder, ash, not only establishes the emblematic example of the Derridean trace, but also, as noted by Robert Eagleston, identifies the ashes of the Holocaust as the known place from which the work of deconstruction begins. As a self-erasing trace of past existence, a lost memory of what is no longer there, the spectral and unpronounceable cinder is, in the Derridean's reading, the lossy of impossible mourning for those others burned in the crematory ovens of the extermination camps, and at the same time the haunting, I quote, excess of lives which resisted annihilation. Someone vanished, but something preserved her trace and at the same time lost it, the cinder. There the cinder is, that which preserves in order no longer to preserve, dooming the remnant to dissolution. Reintroducing to the discursive game two further uneasy oscillations between death and life, presence and absence, the constructive figure of cinder intrinsically implies the enigmatic materiality of ash with another Derridean concept, that of afterlife, survivance. Survivance is the term that I will be exploring a bit. Connoting excessive life that exceeds and follows death, living on or overliving, the concepts of survivance as distinct from that of survival effectively revokes the opposition between our life and death, pointing out the possibility of the survival that is not. An impossible and excessive non-survival in the form of a spectral enigmatic forest. Unsurprisingly, according to James Mackey, I quote, for Derrida, the cinder of the incinerated bodies of the Holocaust victims provide a metaphor for this doubled movement of non-survival and irreducible trace of eradication. As an afterlife of persistent remnant of the past, survivance could indeed be read, as Alexander Keller here suggests, as a discursive grave end of survival and revenants. Nevertheless, the excessiveness of non-survival of the cinder also evokes the politically charged interplay of survival and resistance. The latter contemplation comes from to the fore in the interpretation of this multivocal and notion proposed by Gerald Wiesenthal, building upon and further developing Derrida's dispersed reflections on survivance, the Native American literary critics frames it as something more than mere endurance,
I quote, as an active presence of her absence, dissimulation, and oblivion. The term referring in Wiesner's work to textual strategies employed in contemporary Native American literature, bearing traces and of calling for the shadows or cinders of a reality eradicated through violent process of colonization, does not, however, mean the return to or literary fetishization of traditional Indian cultures. On the contrary, survivance, which does not revoke this eradication, but only subtly reduces the power of the destroyer, in this, it constitutes, according to Wiesner, a domain of post-Indians, self-hybridizing subject creatively and deconstructively reappropriating dominant white identity discourse. As Joe Lockhart puts it elegantly, I quote, survivance incorporates consciousness with which one lives with terms of self-reference imposed by a dominant culture. It places quotation marks around identity preference. As such, therefore, evolves an ironical play with the ideologies of identity intrinsically entwined with and serving as a rationale for violence, to which survivance testifies and which it persistently overlives. Now I will try to explain how it works so much. Interestingly, an attempt to translate Wiesner's textual survivance into enigmatic materiality of cinder could again be facilitated by art. And I over-explored this example, I'm sorry if you know it already, but I think it's really good. As shown in the work of Polish artist and scholar Elżbieta Janicka, the photographic series The Odd Place, the problem of the persistent endurance of the traces of the extermination at the sites at which it takes place does not, after all, have a purely symbolic or metaphorical character. In the 6 large format photographs taken at the former Nazi extermination camps in Poland, Auschwitz-Birkenau, Majdanek, Treblinka, Sobibor, Chełmno, and Belzec, Janicka captured the air drifting above the grounds, penetrated for years by the ashes resurfacing from the graves, which were, in the case of Belzec, Sobibor, Chełmno, and until recently, left almost entirely unprotected. The image, showing white surfaces within black frames and supplemented with inscriptions stating the exact dates of the pictures being taken, represent the tacit circulation of burnt remains above the post-Holocaust landscape. At the same time, the work points out the ongoing relationship between the living and the dead, mediated and sustained through this uncontrollable circulation. The ashes flow in the air. We breathe this air. The ashes are in the soil, in the rivers, on the meadows, and in the forests, subjected to constant recycling in which we participate. As an artistic commentary on the material survivance of the ashes of Holocaust, Janicka's work should nevertheless be read as a more than somewhat unsettling assertion of the already obvious fact that material traces of extermination linger on and cannot be entirely eradicated. The reference, suggested by the title of the work, to the discriminatory police of ghetto benches introduced at Polish universities in 1937, which spatially and symbolically separated Jewish students from their Polish colleagues by forcing the latter to sit on separated benches, makes clear that the Odd Place critically engages with the problem of Polish antisemitism, both pre-war and post-war. The involvement of the work in the broader debate on the wartime complicity of Polish society and on the violence inscribed in the uneven distribution of remembrance between Poles and Jews in the post-1945 Poland is stressed additionally by the foregrounding of black frames enclosing the white images, bearing the inscription Akva, the name of the company which, as a part of IG Farben, of course, also participated in a Nazi extermination policy, for instance, by delivering and Majdanek and Auschwitz. The problem of the frames as selective regimes of othering, enclosing and differentiating people dead and living along the lines, along national lines, is therefore confronted in Janicka's work with that of the material and uncontainable circulation of the remains of the other, discreetly placing quotation marks around identity references. Interestingly, the thesis advanced in the artwork has found a way of confirmation in the reality. When archaeological research was conducted at the former extermination camp at Belzec in the late 90s, it was discovered that the forester's house erected at the site in the 60s was located in the immediate vicinity of one of the mass graves. The well used by its inhabitants was tested, and it was confirmed that the water was contaminated, as one of the inhabitants assumed, by the decomposition products from human corpses, which had penetrated the groundwater. The many families dwelling in the house for almost four decades had been drinking water polluted by the bodily remains of the Belzec dead, unintentionally, corporeally partaking in their decay. In this way, the constant uncontainable flow of ashes and the seepage of bodily fluids of Belzec victims established an exchange between the dead and the living, the Jews and poor, resisting and blurring the ontological and identity-based divisions separating them. From this perspective, the material surveillance of human remains as uneasy object subjects oscillating at the borderline between being and nothingness best speaks to the constructive asymmetry of the cinder. Asymmetricity which not only the quote-unquote revolve forces us to rethink those divisions on the basis of the logic that is not essentially human, but also constitutes the unobtrusive agency of ashes as a locus of differently conceived politics of dead bodies.
Thank you. That is very rich and I think thought-provoking talk. I don't know, when you were talking, I was thinking all the time, okay, this is very interesting, you know, to think from that point of view of ashes and how it blurs many borders that we try to address when we study dead bodies, but that maybe they still remain somehow there, but then when you think about ashes, that all vanishes as well, so probably it will help us very much to rethink also at the theory that we already produce on the base of
That was bodies. The problem, that there are many, many theorizations, also of agency of dead bodies, but ashes lacks it and it needs a separate one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but in a separate one, which also makes me think certain stuff that we assume when we talk about dead bodies. So, I don't know, I suppose there is a lot to discuss. I leave the floor to you to ask questions and comments.
Thank you very much, Susana, and also because you are a bit sick and you made this effort to come to talk to us and you were suffering, you know,
with
your throat and
yeah,
but there are, as Maraya said, was there are like many things in what you said that are extremely suggestive and we always try to kind of bring it home, so to speak, to the Spanish case, because we've been dealing for years, you know, and, you know, but we are mostly dealing with skeletons, which is, and it's a, as you say, it's a different ontology. Like, even when there are like kind of, they are mixing up in a sense. For example, now in some mass graves, people is burying themselves. As there is no space, they kind of burn themselves and bury their own bodies by their relatives who are, you know, in mass graves and whatnot. So these crossovers are also happening here in Spain, no? But, for example, in La Barranca, people, which is this is a mass grave that was, that there are 400 people inside the mass grave, and this was kept by the widows, and they are the women in black, so to speak. And they managed to create a civil cemetery, and now people is burying themselves. I mean, it's a very small place, and then they just cremate. I mean, they say, well, when I die, I want to be cremated and buried by my relatives, which, because this cannot be extreme. So I mean, all of what you've said kind of helps us, you know, think about this crossovers between the living and the death and the will of the, you know, all the, but I was wondering, like, I mean, there are like some things that came to my mind, which is basically related to the commemorative aspects of ashes, because you talked about how they were brought, you know, I don't know how far they've gone. I mean, from Europe, I don't know, because I know probably in the U.S. there are some, in Israel, of course, but I don't know if you have traced, or has anybody traced, you know, how far have they gone. And also, you briefly mentioned the importance of ashes, you know, as a founding element, you know, for these memorials in different places of the world. And I wonder if you could elaborate a little bit on that. And I was also shocked by the photo of Miles Woods, you know, because there was also an exhibition here in Spain a few years ago, and what they did is like they went to a mass grave that was exhumed. They got the earth, so to speak, and the exhibition was, I mean, it was a video installation, so one, you could see yourself walking in the room, and then there was another one with pictures of disappeared, and another one was, it was just the artist with a spade just getting the ground, you know, into boxes, and they brought them to the display place, and they created the map of Spain. So when you walked into the exhibition, you would be dirtying your boots with the earth of coming out from a mass grave, and then the map of Spain was decomposing as more people walked, because I mean they just made the silhouette of Spain, but as people walked by, the Spain was kind of, you know, transforming into ashes, so to speak. I mean, this kind of formlessness that you were talking about. So I mean, this is just like a connection I made with this image you put there. But I was wondering more about, I mean, first, how far they have gone, and you know, if you could elaborate a little bit more on how they when they are memorialized, how they are resubjectivized or not. You know.
I will ask you later some links for that. There was no, I think, systematic research done on the topic, and even the articles written, because these are only articles written on the topic by Don Barr and Jean-Marc Dreyfus are totally pioneering. But one focuses on Israel, one focuses on Europe. But even if I think through the prism of my camps, so to say, from Bajet Sobibor and Treblinka, I know of the example, not many examples of ashes being taken to the United States and also to Argentina, also in both Americas, there were definitely. And there, of course, it's impossible to trace those which are in private possession, even though you can also find references to people visiting the sites and collecting even in the 80s, even in the 90s. I think official burials were mostly performed by communities coming from the same places, for instance, in Poland. So this is one of the arguments of Dunbar, that they were rarely individualized or totally individualized. They were mostly performed by community organizations gathering, for instance, survivors from a particular part of Poland. So the first burial that he described was performed in Tel Aviv by former inhabitants of Zduńska Wola, and it was a community event, but based exactly on the ashes brought by one of the survivors from Poland. So both Dunbar and Jean-Marc Dreyfus suggest that it was mostly an individual, private undertaking, which resulted in community events. So it was opened up or initiated by individuals, later on also by
by various organizations which traveled to Poland to collect the ashes. There were also, of course, former prisoners association that were involved in this project. Throughout Europe, there are also examples of Dutch, for instance, Jews traveling to Auschwitz and collecting ashes from there, and they in turn had several severe problems let's say, handling of the ashes, because they were not admitted at the Jewish cemetery, they were not admitted at the cemetery or the place where collected the ashes of resistance fighters, and actually only in the 90s they were interned at one of the cemeteries. So many of those ashes are, again, when I'm saying ashes, sometimes I mean simply the soil they come from the sites, so of course they were never examined. Were suspended for decades because there were also, apart from Israel, not always space for them to be incorporated. But when they were, it was mostly in a collective idiom, whether it was politicized or religiously framed, as it was in Israel since the establishment of Mount Zion or Yad Vashem, or they were simply communities of survivors, or they were incorporated in various Western European countries into the graves of resistance fighters, because of course in the immediate aftermath of the war this was the frame of commemoration, and not the Holocaust, and not memory of victims.
Are they still available? I mean, so to speak, or is there now like some kind of security so nobody can go again and get more ashes? Or
No. I think at the moment it would be impossible. Also, the reaction to Van Housel's work shows that the last reference to transfer, which I found, was in 1972. And I think afterwards the practice stopped. I think it already in the 60s it stopped, and also around that time the halakhic interpretation of the graves and the ways of approaching them changed. So at the moment, contemporary situation, it would be simply impossible to go to the extermination concentration camp and take the ground, the soil, because it would be halakhically prohibited. So one of the most fascinating issues here is that at the moment we have very strict regulations regarding the treatment of the sites where mass graves are located, where all human remains, resurfacing human remains, small pieces of bones, which are of course still to be found at the sites and just come out from the ground, are being protected and reburied under Radnica supervision. Something like that, the things that happened in the 40s, in the 50s, and even in the 60s would simply be impossible.
But it also applies, for example, to the archaeology of the Holocaust, I mean, when they touch the ground, so to speak.
Well, there are many different methodologies, and most of them actually are...
Non-intrusive, no?
Non-invasive, non-intrusive, but of course different archaeologists implement different methodologies, and Caroline Strelikos, with her Holocaust archaeologists, of course pays the most respect to the implication of the Jewish religious law, but we know of a situation where different things happen. For instance, when in the late 90s, research in Belgium that I mentioned before was carried out, it was done by a Polish archaeologist who previously worked with Andrzej Kolak, who previously worked in Katyn, Charków, and Mielnoje, meaning the exhumations of Polish officers and policemen and so on and so forth, killed by the Soviets in the 40s during the Second World War. And he employed in Belzec, that is at the Holocaust site, the same methodology that he employed in Kharkov, Katyn, and Mielnoje, that is drilling, manual drilling up to the depth of 6 meters in order to establish the exact location of the graves. And he did that in Belzec, but he also did that in Sobibor, and this is one of the reasons why we know where the graves are located nowadays.
And at that time, nothing like a rabbinical commission for the protection of cemeteries existed in Poland. It was actually established as a result of scandals which surrounded Belzec and the erection of the monument of the site. So this is also new, and I think that what is fascinating is that the halakhic responses to what is happening at the sites are also not stable. They are developing, and there is also no consensus among rabbis, among religious authorities as to how to proceed with those sites. So in Belzec, we had a situation with a total breaching of regulations, but it was done because there was no framing at the time. The rabbinical commission was established only afterwards, and since then all works carried out, archaeological works carried out at the sites of the former camps are under rabbinical supervision. And which is also fascinating, those works actually started only recently. Mm-hmm. So even though it was possible to do this kind of research in the 50s, it was obviously, or in the 40s, it was obviously not done. It only started at Belzec in the 90s, at Sobibor it was 2001, and Treblinka even later. And they also show how the situation changes, because Sobibor is also handled differently than Treblinka. Different methodologies are applied, even though there are now rabbinical prescriptions as to how to proceed with it.
I was thinking, when you mentioned how the ashes, when they were brought to Israel, how people considered, even though they didn't need identification, as how they considered the ashes to be their relatives or their friends, and I think I don't want to make the same of bones and ashes, but it also happens with bones sometimes, because I work on exhumations in Spain, for example, and the exhumations that took place before the use of forensic techniques to identify the bones, and people actually didn't need to individualize the bodies. Most of the times they were reburied together. You actually had the coffins full of bones together of different people, so just not individualized. So I think the importance to them, what was important is the symbolic act of reburying mm-hmm. them, and also sometimes it was even very important that they were reburied together. They didn't want to separate them. So I was wondering if you came across this type of desire of the families of the victims, maybe of the relatives, to maintain this community of the dead, also in the case of ashes, which probably in the case of ashes, because it is impossible to individualize, it's even easier to take it as a collective.
It's very much the driving force behind those communal events of preparing the dead. Even if it was not about the whole Jewish nation, as mm-hmm. was framed afterwards, but exactly those small communities of people who survived the camp or came from a particular town and then settled in Israel, that they are very rarely individualized, actually. Okay. In a way that Jean-Marc Dreyfus described one situation in some French cemetery in which at the grave it is said that here is buried the urn of my taken from one particular camp where my wife and a daughter died, and their ashes are in this grave. This is a very rare case of privatization and individualization in this case. But I was wondering, were there or are there any DNA tests performed in this Spanish case?
No, since the 2000 years, in the 21st century, not before.
Starting 2005, more or less, because there was no money and the technology was not available, and then they were done in a pretty decent old fashion. I mean, the state was not supporting, you know. Now there are like two or three DNA banks being constructed mm-hmm. in Spain, but it's now 16 years after the beginning of the process, so it's coming too late. But the arrival of DNA totally transformed mm-hmm. what Zoe was talking about. I mean, like this community of death, people would understand that maybe their relative was there. It's kind of undifferentiated there, because there was no way of establishing concrete scientific identifications. So they took them as their own. And there is a very interesting process here in Spain, which probably you also find it in relation to the ashes, which is like the adoption of bodies, like just very intuitive, like this is my grandfather. And I mean, just like this, because I have this intuition, or my heart was beating faster, when I walk by it. And so they kind of assimilate. And then, the genetic identification may say otherwise, but it's something that happens very often in the exhumation, like they are here. Mm-hmm. He's this one. No? Maybe with the ashes, you can, even in their indifferentiation, you can have similar processes, psychological processes. I don't know.
I have one more question. I'm sorry about
yeah.
not this direction. But all the DNA identification came later, but was it also retroactively applied to the graves that were exhumed earlier or not?
Not yet. There are some cases, there are some, for example, in one of the cases I studied, the bones were exhumed in the 70s. And later, a relative of one of the persons that were exhumed, supposedly then, he knew about it later. He didn't know the grave had been exhumed, etc. And now he would like to perform the DNA test. I'm not sure if it's possible scientifically, but it's, I think, the only case like this we have come across.
Well, we have another one from in Valencia also. They exhumed, I mean, they had a mass grave, and they were going to make changes in the cemetery, so the priest called some of the relatives, and they showed up, only a few of them, and he gave them bones, mm-hmm. and they put these bones in milk cases mm-hmm. from the American aid that mm-hmm. came to Spain, and they buried these boxes in their family pantheons, and one of the families did the DNA, and of course there was no connection whatsoever between the bones that they received and any kind of genetic match. So I mean, this has also happened, because DNA contaminates, so to speak, mm-hmm. the way in which we relate to bodies in a very heavy way.
Yeah, it does. I had an example like that. There is an organization that gathers relatives of the victims of Sobibor in the Netherlands, in Sobibor. Mm-hmm. And they actually still wonder why no DNA tests were performed on the remains that are uncovered during research at the site. Mm-hmm. So, of course, they project even if it's scientifically or in any other way impossible, they project this imagery of possibility to the individual as make people into names again, which is fascinating.
I have a question, well, two questions. One is about your theoretical part, but I'm not sure if it's going to be. I still have to digest it better. And one is a more practical question. We're talking all the time about ashes are recollected by Jewish groups. Mm-hmm. Do you know any cases of ashes being recollected by other groups, like Gypsies or...?
Mm, maybe not Roma, I don't know. Uh-huh. But also a resistance fighters organization and political prisoners organization collected.
Yeah, yes. And they have that same kind of... placing these ashes at a certain memorial, so they have the same kind of practices towards these ashes.
Yeah, and there is even a hypothesis, I think it's Jean-Marc Dreyfus who claims that since it's so totally incompatible with Jewish tradition and Jewish understanding mm-hmm. of their bodies, that probably it was driven by their practices mm-hmm. or taken from the practices of political prisons.
And then my more theoretical question, when you were starting your presentation, I was all the time thinking, okay, this is the whole question about who represents these deaths. Can an artist take these ashes?
who can take these ashes, what can you do with it, or who is in the end, who can speak for these deaths. And then at your conclusion, where you talk about survivance, and you use these examples of how in the end these traces, these material traces, they are in the lives of people who surround the campsite or surround the grave, how they're kind of materially related mm-hmm. with those. Isn't it then still somehow a question of representation, although it is non-wanted representation?
Yeah,
let's say that you are trying to tackle in a way.
Yeah, I think it's unavoidable, unfortunately.
Yeah, so and then my question is, where stays in the end this agency, you know, of the thing or of the dead body or of
some olden sites representation? Mm-hmm. It's of course a trap, because if I think about the material agency of materiality mm-hmm. and still articulate it or try to articulate it in political terms, mm-hmm. Then I end up, of course, reproducing the gaze of a human, but
yeah.
Unfortunately, I don't think I can resist it mm-hmm. in a way that
yeah.
It's very difficult to, and many struggle with it, how to think about the agency of materiality, not even, of course, of the bodies, but various forms of agency of materiality without getting onto the side of pre-post-anthropocentric perspectives. But I think even making the room and asking the questions is
mm-hmm.
still
yeah.
lets them in and so somehow makes possible even a subtle framing of how they act and how they force us and how they influence us.
Mm-hmm.
But of course, me and as a human being, only have my human tools to articulate
yeah.
it. It's a challenge, definitely.
Yeah, yeah.
Religious beliefs and materiality in terms, because for example, obviously then it seems that the Polish state is assuming a Jewish authority. You know, it's a Catholic state and it's assuming Jewish authority over or Jewish monopoly over, you know, the treatment of, but not all of them were Jews, for that matter, no. And so that's one question. I mean, how come that the Polish state kind of allows, you know, the treatment of this to be, you know, monopolized by the Jewish
mm-hmm.
religious laws, and also just to have a little contrast with the Spanish case, no? I don't know. Probably you know that a few weeks ago there was like a ruling by the church regarding the treatment of ashes, that was like, I mean, the church assuming that you can be cremated. I mean, it's not totally related, but it has, I mean, may as help us think about these issues. No? And they would say, okay, if you can cremate your relatives, but only if then they are buried, you know, in a sacred place
mm-hmm.
or by other bones or in a place where they can be commemorated in a Catholic way. If you throw them in the air or yes in the sea, you are contradicting, you know, Catholic funerary practices and whatnot.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's on the one part. But then we also have a case in Spanish exhumations. I mean, most of them since the year 2000 have been Republicans who were killed in the behind the lines, so to speak, no, civilians who were killed behind the lines by the winners in the Civil War. But there was also Republican repression during the Civil War, although it was exhumed during the dictatorship, no? And it continues on. And part of it is related to the those religious servants who were killed by the Republicans, by communist anarchists or whatever. No? So as of today, they are still, I mean, the process in which they go through is that they exhume them with religious paraphernalia and whatnot, and then they cut them in pieces, because we are talking about relics here, no?
Mm-hmm.
So they get the bones and they piece them, and then they make like reliquaries and they distribute them around Spain. So they just, which is a process which gets bit closer to the ash than to the I mean, I don't know, there is like a decomposition of the bone because of religious, I don't know, it's just a wild kind of thinking that, but I mean, and the actual question was the first one about the police state and the monopoly of the Jewish rabbis on the treatment of human remains in the Holocaust sites.
Of course, it wasn't like that, and from the 40s until actually very recently, this was not the case. And it's to a great extent a question of diplomacy and publicity, which always is very well rich when from the perspective of Jewish community. Mostly that that abroad, Polish state or Polish authorities in some way disturb or disrespect or violate. So this is to a great extent a question of diplomacy, and political instrumentalization of Holocaust commemoration. Yeah, it comes with Polish states being part of EU and being forced also to follow certain regulations, but of course it's not an uncontested issue, and there is one rabbinical authority at the moment in Poland, the Commission for the Cemeteries, Rabbinical Commission for the Cemeteries, which decides on how to proceed with all graves, and it also represents a certain religious orientation, which even though the Rabbi Shut, chief rabbi of Poland, was to be reformed, the regulation that they follow are ultra-orthodox and come from London, from the Central Commission for the Cemeteries, which means that it also imposes a certain religious interpretation on the graves of people who could not be religious of, at all, could be assimilated, could be a communist, and of course it's also rather problematic and contested from the, even if you do not introduce the Polish state and Polish authorities to the game, from the perspective of Jewish community it's contested from the very beginning. How you frame it and why you frame it in this way, and then comes the Polish state, which reacts and allows because of the scandals which always break out when Poles start or Polish archaeologists start digging in the Jewish graves. Of course, I always gonna say Poles, Jews, and so on. Because we are set on constructs very often antagonistically working in this field, but. There are examples when the situations are treated in a slightly different way. For example, when the investigation was carried out, which related to Jedwabne, the massacre, the mass killings of very brutal of Jewish inhabitants of Polish town by Poles in 1941, the grave was actually opened, and. Only very recently, the chief rabbi of Poland publicly admitted that he allowed to open the grave, but did not allow the bodies to be taken for any kind of examination. So the grave was uncovered. The research or investigation was carried out on the first layer of human remains. They were skeletons, and they were not taken for an investigation. And in Polish press and Polish media coverage, that was not made public. So everybody thought that the bodies, the skeletons, were actually forensically examined in laboratories and so on and so forth. This was some kind of strange compromise between Polish authorities and rabbinical authorities. And now, there is after it was made public, there is an official campaign and campaign of collecting signatures and so on and so forth. And many people actually demand a proper exhumation and examination of the corpses to take place. And since we have the new government, this is my contribution to the 13th of December.
a new law of Institute of National Remembrance, which is responsible for the it's an investigative and research institutions, which institutions which is responsible for many of the exhumations, was changed, and now actually it opens space for investigation also of graves containing Jews. Jewish bodies, because for some mysterious reason, the most right-wing government that we that we had since the transformation decided to redefine Polish citizen in civic terms and not in religious or ethnic or any other. And the new law grants the Institute of National Memory permission to investigate in case of crimes committed against Polish citizens, regardless of the religious, ethnic, and so on background. So actually, the new regulation opens space for archaeological and forensic investigations at the sites where until now rabbis, rabbinical commission would not permit to do it. So now we have since 2016 a new situation, which can result in changing the symmetry and actually the, well, your question will be invalidated, which is also problematic.
Okay. We'll follow into disputes over, with the rabbis, I suppose.
Yeah, okay. The whole status quo of allowing the rabbis to
have the final word on what's
was a result of those many conflicts. But now the there was no legal, let's say, no clear legal framework for that. And now there is a legal framework for that. And it, of course, it's also related to those sites which are very multi-layered. That, for instance, first function as Nazi or German prisons, for instance, then Soviet prisons, then again, and so on and so forth. And you have many bodies buried of political prisoners, of Jewish civilians exterminated, and sometimes the archaeologists who are searching for the victims of Soviet totalitarian regime uncover, for example, graves full of female bodies, and they do not know how to proceed in a situation like that. So the first, of course, thought that they come across is that they are not Polish political underground fighters but Jewish women. And also situations like that in those multi-layered sites which function as many different prisons, for instance, and execution sites always cause this kind of problems. And this new regulation, of course, serves to get rid of them. So it allows the archaeologists to go for their victims of totalitarian regime, regardless of the fact that that there also are buried the bodies of women executed.
Is it also a kind of politics of extending the victimhood of
yes,
Polish,
of course,
if the Jews then are also Polish victims, then
yes, of course. It's also fascinating because it's not only the synchronic but also the diachronic, so to say, because the new regulation actually in the Institute of National Memory was mostly focused on Second World War, and now it's 56 and 1918. In both temporal and populational, so to say, terms, it definitely extends the victimhood and also redefines terror and crimes against the Polish nation.
Yeah,
yeah, but it's also the fascinating play with the notion of citizenship, because in Poland it's of course one of those countries which never. Never fully digested the civic definition of citizenship, and now it seems in the most right wing times they do.
comments or questions or I think then we can kind of wrap it up at this moment, talk more about modern Polish politics maybe over lunch, for which we will invite you and for which you can all join here at the restaurant of the institute. So again, thank you a lot. Thank you a lot for coming, although your physical material situation was, we'll keep on talking. Our next session of Faces and Traces of Violence será en febrero. Sí, en enero tenemos un descanso, así que en febrero ya mandaremos qué fecha va a ser exactamente. Y, well, thanks.
Thank you very much.